Good afternoon, folks. Glad to have you here. I am Esther, SJ President, and I am really glad to, on behalf of Broward, introduce you to our Friday forum of this week. Special honor guest, the artist and photographer, Marcelo Coelho. Please, Marcelo, come here, introduce yourself. Thank you for your presence.
Thank you. And first of all, thanks everybody, né, from the Broward University and Gleice, who invited me, Luciana, Ana Cristina. It's a pleasure to be here with you guys and to talk about my long story in photography. I actually started as a civil engineer. So when I was growing up, I was a very visual person and always, you know, cutting pictures from magazines to create my own magazine. I wanted to travel the world and things like this. And but I was pretty much raised to be an engineer or a lawyer or a doctor. You know, at the time, the options were not very wide as it is now. But and so I was really into architecture. I was very visual and I was doing 3D renderings for architecture when I was, you know, a teenager. And at a time to do vestibular, né, we didn't have a name at the time. My parents pretty much said, well, you know, architecture, if engineering is not really well right now, this was 1980, so there was a big economic crisis at the time. So I went to engineering. But at the end of the program, I decided to study architecture, which I did for 2.5 years. I didn't finish. And that's the time when I decided to give up everything and go to the US. I was thinking about New York, but I had my sister was living in Los Angeles at the time. So that's what I did. I went to Los Angeles thinking about, you know, maybe joining in a school or something. But I did a few courses, photography courses, classes, and I ended up working for a Brazilian photographer in Los Angeles for 2 years from São Paulo. I mean, I worked for a few other photographers too, but worked for this guy named Cesar Lima. And after 2 years, I started my own studio. So that was 1994. I started a studio in Venice Beach, California, which is part of Los Angeles. And it was pretty much, I was self-taught in photography. I at the time, I thought I was too old to go to school again because I was in my late 20s and I had already gone through, you know, 5-6 years of engineering plus 2 years of architecture. So I decided to just do my own work, and I went after shooting mostly like street photography. So I would just go out to the streets in Los Angeles and shoot as much as I could, whatever would attract my attention. A lot of people ask, you know, what kind of subjects are interesting today for the market and things like this. And I tell people that it is really what's inside of you that matters the most when you're choosing what to do in photography or any art, I think. You first have to look inside to then think, you know, what are you going to do? I think the market is always there. And we tend to think, for example, I remember before I opened the studio, I went to a few of those meetings of the, it's called the APA, which is the Association of Photographers of America. So I became a member and I started going to the meetings. In one of these meetings, this big photographer, he said, well, if you want to stay in Los Angeles to be a photographer, you will have to be either a car photographer, an editorial photographer, or a fashion photographer. And I thought, oh my God, I'm none of those, you know, what I'm gonna do? And I didn't think about a specialty. So I felt a little like, oh my God, I'm in the wrong place, what I'm gonna do? And I decided that I never went back to those meetings. I decided that I was going to go out to the streets and start shooting my own work. And so I really became a self-taught. And after working for this guy for 2 years, he was really into Photoshop and all the editing, programs and the computer, digital stuff. And I was more into the actual process of shooting. So I learned a lot from that. And I finally opened the studio. And I had a partner who was this guy that came from London, from a branding firm in London called Lendor. And this was a very interesting experience for me because he had a whole different way of thinking in terms of communication. And at the time, it was right around the time, this was like mid-90s, right around the time when branding and strategic communications was really like starting in the US and some parts of Europe. And so I had a very good experience with him. And from that, I started shooting for some of the strategic communication offices in Los Angeles. And that gave me a lot of feedback, a lot of interesting kind of connection with photography, because it's the kind of work that where the concept was very important, not so much the technical side. Or, for example, when you shoot for advertising, most of the times they give you the layout. It's pretty much, almost ready for you to, you pretty much have to follow the visual references and you have to shoot what they want. Now, in strategic communication, which we call branding, there's a lot more creative freedom. And so the interesting part is that you're working with a good idea, interesting subjects, and then your personal point of view is very important to that kind of work, which is very interesting for me, was very interesting at the beginning because I didn't follow fine art photography. I don't consider myself an art photographer because I didn't go to school for fine art. I don't have a big, a background of knowledge in the art. And so I consider me more of a creative professional instead of an artist. A lot of people call, they think, I'm an artist because I'm a photographer, but I consider myself more a creative person. After a few years, I decided to close my studio in Los Angeles, and I decided to focus my work into the whole visual storytelling form of art or form of communication or expression. And I'm going to talk a little bit about it here today for you guys so that you have an idea of all of what it's kind of encompassed in visual storytelling. It really started in the 60s and 70s when two directors in California started shooting their documentaries using smaller cameras. And what was interesting about this is that at the time, technology was, making cameras smaller and smarter. And so you could shoot a lot of natural lighting with small cameras. You didn't have all that equipment that you needed for cinema, for example, for big film productions. So they were able to get into the subject a little more without having a preconceived script. So instead of going into a subject with a script in front of you and you know every scene that you're going to record, they started following a more kind of like journalism, you would say, or, you know, a documentary style where you would immerse yourself into the subject and shoot as the story is developing. So it's, I mean, of course you have an idea of what you want, you have a concept of what you want, but you can be a lot more spontaneous with the process of shooting because you go into the subject and you discover along as the story is unfolding in front of you. So what was interesting is that in the early 2000s, when I was young in the 80s, I used to watch MTV all the time. And I loved watching those music videos because they were very artistic. And most of you guys, of course, were not there at the time. But it was great to watch all those video clips with more of an artistic kind of creative approach. And in the early 2000s, I found Vimeo, you know, which is a video platform. And I started researching a lot about the personal films that people were doing, like short documentaries, like 3 to 4 minutes, 5 minutes at the most, but with a personal kind of style. And I soon realized that those could be interesting subjects for branding, for communication, for brands to communicate themselves. And in the late 2010, I decided to come back to Brazil after almost 20 years in Los Angeles. And then after a while here, I started working, you know, for some of the branding firms and all that. And I started noticing how the whole brand awareness communication started like growing super fast, you know. So in the last 10 years, we've seen a huge expansion into that area of communication. And I think that in Brazil, we are still doing a lot of work that has, you know, a more kind of like, I would say like a corporate kind of approach. But I know that the whole thing is kind of like evolving into a type of communication where brands are going to talk more about real issues instead of talking about themselves all the time. So instead of the brand being the actual protagonist of the story, we're going to see more and more of brands getting involved with real issues, you know, and so that's a great area for anyone who wants to do documentary work with a personal perspective, because that's the other interesting thing, that you can have any story to be told by anyone, you know. Every person is going to do it differently. So that's the beauty of it. So anyways, after a few years, I was really wanting to do my film work, and I was always so busy with photography. And finally, in 2018, I had a very good opportunity because there was an event in the US called Burning Man. Some of you, or many of you, have probably heard of it, which is a cultural social event in the desert in Arizona. A lot of people think it's a electronic music festival. There is a lot of electronic music, but it's not an electronic music festival. It's a lot more than that. 75,000 people in the desert once a year for 10 days. And they bring all kinds of amazing pieces of art, design, technology, architecture. There's all kinds of music. There is hundreds and hundreds of these large trucks that they decorate or they design anything they want. You can design anything you think of and bring to Burning Man. If it's not allowed in the streets, it's allowed in Burning Man. That's one of the rules. So it's a very interesting event, and it's a very visual event. So I've been planning to go for many, many years. And I finally made in 2018, and I produced a short documentary, which you guys are gonna see now.
This is one of the peculiar problems of our culture. That we are terrified of our feelings because they take off on their own. And we think that if we give them any scope and if we don't immediately beat them down, they will lead us into all kinds of chaotic and destructive action. It's so funny that we in our Western culture today say that kind of thing. We who do more chaotic and reckless kind of action than anybody ever did. The only thing that could be bad is to take it too seriously.
Okay, so anyways, one interesting thing about this film is that I took all my equipment to the desert out there, my case with cameras and lenses and everything I had. And when I was there, I realized that for me to walk around a place like this with the large camera and lenses and, you know, stabilizer, all these things, it would be very kind of intrusive. And of course, a lot of people are there. They just want to have fun. They are not there to be filmed or photographed. And so pretty much I never took my camera out of my case. I took my cell phone And I shot this entire film with my cell phone because that gave me the ability to be part of the party, you know, be part of the event, kind of like get into it without having all that heavy equipment with me and all that. Instead of being like a professional filmmaker or something, I was just another person in there. And so that that is a good example of how interesting documentaries are made, because it's not so much about the equipment and about the script and things like this. It's more about like what you want to capture, what you're trying to convey, you know, with your thoughts, with your idea. And to me, the equipment really doesn't matter so much. So that was shot with an iPhone, pretty much. The after that film, I ended up really, that film was really the beginning of my career as a video maker. I don't consider myself a filmmaker or a cinematographer, because I think it's a little different. And I didn't have, you know, I didn't go to school for that. But so as a video maker, I wanted to tell my stories. I mean, I still shoot photography and I'm a photographer too, but a film gave me so many other opportunities to tell stories with that style that we're talking about here, the visual storytelling. And the next film I did was for a nonprofit organization in Trancoso, which for those of you who don't know, well, most people here are Brazilian, so you know. But it's a small village in the coast of Bahia. And it's a place that became, you know, an international tourist attraction, but it's also home to thousands of people who come from, you know, the surrounding cities and all that, just to get work to survive. So there's a lot of hotels and houses over there. And so there's another side of Trancoso, which people don't see most of the times, where you have communities that are very poor and people who maybe don't have enough money to go to school and things like this. So Despertar was started, I guess, 10 years ago. And they invited me to do a film about their story without really being a corporate type film, you know. So as you're going to see, we're not trying to really explain so much what they do. So we're going to tell the story through the life of this man that is one of the guys who their kids went to Despertar and they were able from there to go to school, even university after that, but they lived in poor communities and all that. So we're going to see that film now, Despertar.
Vendendo camarão na praia muitos anos atrás. Então resolvi introduzir as flores no Trancoso porque ninguém mexia com isso aqui. A minha família vive cercada de flores, isso é uma coisa maravilhosa.
começou a fazer curso na Despertar, e isso deu oportunidade para eles fazer a faculdade e conseguir trabalho também. A partir daí, os horizontes foram se abrindo para a minha família, que a gente até conseguiu comprar mais terra, cultivar mais flores para expandir mais o negócio.
Thank you. So, anyways, before we go into the photography, some of the photography projects I'm going to show you guys, just going back to this form of expression that we call visual storytelling, the ability to show real stories with a personal point of view, I think it's, you know, maybe one of the most interesting things about it. And also the chance to explore something with its essence, you know, so you don't go with a preconceived idea. You're not really directing people what to do. Like, for example, in this film, every scene that you see here, they were just stuff that was happening. So I was just there with the camera. So you have to spend more time, of course, you know, spend some time to get more into the subject, to get familiar with this guy, for example, the flower guy. I went to spend a couple days, you know, with him and his family to see how they pick the flowers and things like this. So it's a great way to show stories with that kind of like approach. You know, it's a more intuitive way of telling stories. And the other thing is that you can go beyond the obvious, which is, you know, the name of the film, Burning Man, which is something that I'm always interested in, to really kind of like try to push my eyes to see what it's beyond the obvious in front of you. So that's the other point. And the thing is to be able to capture experiences, you know, emotions, memories, imagination. You become more involved with, like I said, you know, the essence of the stories. And what we see now, which is very interesting, is that visual storytelling is really like everywhere you see. So there's a lot of the big sports brands that are doing storytelling, a lot of the social issues, social responsibility, things involved with culture, you know. So there's so many things you can do. So I've done almost like 20 films so far in this last 3 years. And now I'm going, you know, to the next point for me, which is to start using editors to kind of like be able to tie the stories together, you know, like, which is very interesting. Editing is another form of art that I think it's so interesting, where you can tie things and make into a story, you know. So let's see, let's show the first project, the first photo project, which is called Piselli. which is the story of this guy. It's a very interesting story. It became a book called From Peace, from Ville would be Sweet Peace, From Peace to Piselli. The story of this man, which is this guy over here, is that he started his adult life by trying to plant sweet peas in the countryside in São Paulo, and he failed. He planted the peas in a way that he couldn't sell them afterwards. Anyway, he had to throw everything in the trash. And so he decided to go to São Paulo and start his life in São Paulo. And from there, he went, you know, to study wine and all that. And he started his own restaurant called Piselli, because his family is like from Italy and all that. So this is the story of us going to Italy. This is his grandfather, actually, the guy who put his name as Juscelino because of Juscelino Kubitschek, the president. And there was, anyway, so this is his restaurant. He started the restaurant when he was 35 years old. And then he decided to go to Italy, where his family was, you know, all of his ancestors were from Italy. So he goes to Italy to select the wine for the restaurant. And so I went with him, and we got to, you know, I kind of pretty much followed him through all this kind of vineyards and wineries of Italy. This is his restaurant, where he goes to pick the to get to know all these different parts of north of Italy to select the wine. So the work again is more like we didn't have a rigid script to follow. So everything was really just, you know, happening as we traveled. And it was just about capturing scenes of, you know, day-to-day kind of situations. This guy just came out of this wine store in Oteca. He looked at me and I took the photo. So we went to all these amazing villages where he was, you know, looking for wine pretty much. And of course, you know, you could see all the culture happening. And this became actually, these photos, they turned into a photo exhibition. So when the restaurant became, the first year, the first anniversary, they had an exhibition. We stayed in a castle for 3 days, which was amazing. And those are some of the situations. This is like, you know, one of those little tricycles with man and his wife. And Yeah, that's this amazing architecture, the wine. Tetra Tech was another story that was very interesting because I got to travel all over the US for a few years for this company. They are involved with renewable energy and water conservation. So the interesting thing here is that this is a company that works, it's a very large company that works with these big major projects in the US. But how do you show these projects? It was the challenge. So our idea was to really kind of like travel around and reveal these unexpected connections between general people, daily lives, you know, with the environment and with this company's role to improve the environment. So they have everything from wind turbines to solar energy and things like this, and engineering for sustainable buildings. So instead of shooting the actual facilities of the company, we chose to travel around the US and photograph things that were indirectly connected to what they do, you know, to reveal that what are the long-term impacts. Like, for example, here you see farms where they're installing all these wind turbines all over, you know, the north of the US. This is one of the farmers. So again, a bit more like a documentary style of work where you're just, you know, shooting interesting things that they go. Like electricity, for example, that's a way to show how everything, they're going towards solar and wind to generate electricity for the state of New York. I think in 10 years, they want to be 75% renewable energy there. Yes, YMCA is a very interesting story too, case, because when I went to shoot for the YMCA, they were very much into posed photographs of people in the YMCA, like smiling to the camera and things like this. And I went with this idea of, why don't we just capture real things as they're happening? I'm sure we're gonna get a lot of great things. And they trusted me, and I ended up shooting this work for their annual report. And so the interesting thing is that the YMCA is pretty much in almost every community and every neighborhood in the US. It's a very large organization. I think they're like in 30 countries or something like that. It's a huge nonprofit organization. But their communication was very kind of, in a way, traditional and boring, and you always see people smiling to the camera and just looking at the camera and all that. And so the whole point was to shoot more of like a lifestyle type situation where I would pretty much like blend in the people there and again, spend time with them so that people are actually get used to the camera in there. And that way I was able to capture a lot of the spontaneity and the reality of what it is like, you know, to spend a day at the YMCA pretty much. Yeah, the next project is an organization, nonprofit organization in São Paulo called CIEB, which is the Center for Innovation in Brazilian Education. They're pretty much an association formed by a few of the foundations, of the large foundations in Brazil. They got together and decided to do one institution only for to study innovation and to bring that to public education. So I went to two public schools in São Paulo, and again, I just was, you know, shooting as things were happening, and so there's no interference, you know, direction or anything in the scenes. They were just happening. And this was used for their all their kind of marketing materials to promote, you know, the foundation, the association. And this is the last project I'm going to show today, which is a project that I did in 2013-14 for Vale, the mining company. They pretty much, you know, they have operations in many countries. And one thing that when Vale expanded into the world, they left, you know, Brazil to go to other countries. The first challenge, of course, was to face all these different cultures. This work was a form of kind of like to bring all these different countries, different cultures, to one kind of like form of communication for them. What was interesting about this is that as I went to visit Vale's facilities everywhere in the world, I would take some time to shoot personal photography, personal work for me. So those images, of course, none of these are Vale's facilities, but all of these images became part of a book that they created for the investors. So they produced a book as a gift for the end of the year. And because if you think what they sell is really everywhere, that even in a cell phone or in a car, in a building, everywhere you go. Which is minerals, pretty much. And so we really kind of like got to this is in Shanghai, so nightlife in Shanghai. Anyways, so it was very kind of like amazing travel, because I went to like 15 countries and visit all these different cultures. And I think it was the first time also that they used this kind of imagery. Because they're very used to show more of their own facilities, their own, you know, employees, you know, their own environment. And so I think that this was a very interesting opportunity for them to kind of like open their minds to show how the impact of what they do is like in so many places, you know, in society. And so this work also was became an exhibition a few years later called Encounters. This is in Toronto, Canada. Peru. I think that's it, right? All right. Well, that's pretty much it. Of course, I could show a lot more projects, but I picked those to show you guys and to give you know, some idea of the type of work I've been doing. I would like to finish just saying that it's really a great area for people that are coming out to the market now to explore really, you know, real issues. I think brands are starting to, clients in general, and not only that, but the nonprofit organizations and everyone starting to becoming more involved with real issues, I think, you know, with society in general. So if you're someone who is involved with culture, and you know, you can go towards that subject. If you're involved with dance or art or architecture, so there's so many opportunities now. I think that we're actually seeing a big kind of change in the way that we communicate with each other. I mean, social media, of course, has a big influence on that, because we really changed how we communicate. These days, we show our routine or our, you know, what we see most of the times is like what's really happening, right? And so we're not really producing stuff. We're like more just showing the reality of things all the time. So I think it's a great time to kind of express so many different ideas and points of view, because in the last 30, 40 years, I think a lot of what we saw was kind of like produced by marketing, maybe like marketing professionals. And so it had a very kind of like a specific language. And now creatives, artists, we can really kind of like put our point of view into what we do, and it's accepted a lot more. So when you go out and you see what a lot of these big players, big brands are doing out there, and these new digital communication firms are doing, it's very exciting and it's very authentic. I think authenticity has a lot to do with what's going on right now, and it's very exciting. So anyways, I think that's pretty much it. I don't know if anyone wants to ask questions. Yes?
Okay, thank you. You mentioned for a bit, I mean, your proposition is to bring authenticity, intuition, and creativity to your photos, which is at least most of people, and most of the time we think, enslaved by publicity, advertisements, the creative thinking and the creative perspective is hindered. I wanted to know more about how this relationship can be overcome to you, or if you don't have much problem with expressing your creativity while working for companies, like you said, YMCA or CM.
Well, I think that the evolution of communication now is that less and less of the story is being created in in an ad, you know, in you talked about publicity. If you think of all the advertising that's been done in the last 40, 50 years, it was always an idea that came from an office, from an ad agency, from creatives inside an office thinking about a story. And what's happening now is that as the world becomes more and more complex, then it's, I think that communication people and their clients, the brands, are understanding that it's more important to go out there and really see what's happening out there. So you can have a previous concept, an idea, but you're not really so much like creating a story ready, you know, from an office, and you go out there and you direct that whole thing. It's more like to explore real issues. I think that became very clear in the 90s. I remember during the Iraq war, where there was some big issues happening with some of the American brands that were around the world, and then a lot of kind of, you know, people that were unhappy with that whole thing happening, the war, and so there was a lot of disconnection, and a lot of brands who started losing space, and they realized that brands could no longer be just an entity to create profit. They had to become like more involved with society in general. So I guess that's when, that's how this whole point of like telling real stories kind of like started to expand, you know, more. Did I answer your question? Mm-hmm.
Okay, hi. Well, thank you for the presentation. I mean, that was really, really interesting, very inspirational. You know, I think we could go like talking hours about the photos, each one of the photos, the videos specifically. That's it's a very nice thing. And to see that you're doing that with, let's say, modern day contemporary equipment, like the iPhone and like different or like a more original forms of filming and taking pictures, that's very interesting. And well, it just makes me excited to, you know, to see what's up there in the future, you know, to work in this field in this area. Well I didn't formulate my question like let's say so clearly in my head, so it might sound a little abstract, but I think that my question is, well, we all heard that there's the best camera that you have is in your pocket, right? Which is your phone. And well, I think with a video you proved that pretty well, because well, I just have to talk about it. I'm not gonna go too deep in it, because I mean, as I said, this could go hours going, but it's like that video, even from an expressive point of view, it makes sense to be using a phone, you know, like specifically an iPhone, because you said it's about the experience of being in this festival, and that captures a very specific point of view inside of that festival. So I really liked it. And we see that there's a lot of young people like me or like whoever like to take pictures and to get into this universe. And they often use their phones and the equipment that they have. Would you say that, or do you have some sort of, let's say, not method, but perspective to identify some sort of talent and identify some sort of originality of expression and vision in these more amateurish-like pictures made with phones with younger people, to maybe, I don't know, give them some sort of direction to be like better photographers, better video makers, something like that? Like for you to have... To identify some sort of originality in the work of like amateurish filmmakers, video makers, photographers, that they're using their phones and the equipment that they have. How do you identify originality in that, you know?
Well, originality is really a very personal issue. I think that, for example, a lot of photojournalists that in the 80s and or 70s, 80s, 90s, they were shooting war sometimes. I remember like in the 90s when I was in Los Angeles, that war photography, a lot of gallerists, a lot of gallery curators started looking at war photography and it became huge in art. But no one was looking at that before. So I think that it's really kind of like you have so many things that are involved with that. You have trends, what's happening right now. For example, we saw in the US last year, all the protests, you know, with the whole thing, the police violence in the US and all that. Then in Europe, protests against, you know, government stuff. And so I think that the way to really see originality in someone's work is when you can follow that person's work and kind of like see some kind of a line that ties everything together. And the way that I understand originality is when instead of looking at the market to see what you could do to sell your work, is the opposite would be to, like I said in the beginning, to get into like your way of seeing the world and what is in your point of view that you can put into images. I think that's how originality comes in, you know.
So I have two questions. The first is, you mentioned that you didn't go to school for photography and you were working in Los Angeles, which was a very competitive environment. And you mentioned those three things that were very popular in Los Angeles, like cars, people, I don't remember the third one, and fashion, yeah. But how did you, as an independent person, transition to working with businesses? Like, how did you become recognized? And the second question I'll ask after.
Well, in the beginning, I had to survive. I had to pay the bills, pretty much. So I did a lot of shootings in the beginning, shooting products for catalogs. Because, I don't know, it was just easier to get clients and to get that kind of work. So, but of course, I knew that I wasn't going to do that for the rest of my life. So after a couple of years, I started pretty much meeting some graphic designers. And I really started, I think a lot of what I, in the beginning, I used a lot of like personal networking. So it's really like, I really started like around the people that I knew. So they knew that I was into photography. And so I started kind of like searching who knows a graphic designer. Someone would introduce me to a graphic designer. And a few times, I really kind of like, I really went straight after a design office that I liked the work that I saw in magazines or something, and I really just called them and I say, can I show my portfolio? So there was a lot of that too. But of course that I think that persistence is another thing that is very important in the beginning, because maybe you go 2, 3, 4 months without much success, but then at a point, at sometimes eventually you will get lucky. I would say luck is very relative term. You get lucky and you meet a very cool design firm, for example, like I did, you know. So I think it's a combination of persistence and knowing kind of like where you want to go with your work, what kind of work you want to do. Like I said, coming from inside, you know, what is that moves you? And that's what gives us motivation pretty much to get up in the morning and kind of like, you know, keep going. Even if sometimes seems like it's becoming difficult, but if you keep going. So I think it's the persistence of doing the same thing over and over and over and over again. And once in a while, you find the right people, you connect with the right people, and then you start getting a lot of referrals. So that's the other great thing too, because once you start, you know, getting your work out there, then you really get referred to from one client to go to the next. You know, that's how I think it works.
It's nice that you mentioned that you have to be proactive, but luck is also involved. But for my second question is that after you had one, maybe two big jobs, and you started becoming like you were more trusted by your clients and you had that recognition, how did you use that freedom that they might have given you now that they trusted you?
You know, this is a very interesting question, because the way that I was able to get trusted, to use my own point of view, was to bring a lot of my personal point of view to my work. So it's kind of interesting because it's a two-way thing. It's kind of like for you to get your personal point of view into the work out there, you really have to go after what it is your point of view first, and then I would mix that into my portfolio. So when I would go to a new agency or a new client or a new design firm, I always mixed personal with work. And I was almost doing the opposite of what most people were doing at the time. Because, for example, if you wanted to be a product photographer, you would show a lot of maybe watches, you know, nice shoes, and you would have a very kind of like a specific portfolio. So I would do the opposite. I would mix, you know, personal things in my portfolio, and I like I said, I think that the people that you have to know, of course, where to go to. So it's easy to see who is doing the most creative work. You know, there are agencies that are more interested in the traditional advertising. So all they're showing is products and services and how to sell. You know, if you look through the magazines, for example, most of the big ads you're going to see are so similar to each other in a way, you know. But that's kind of like going away, I think. You know, what's coming out now is more of the content that we see in social media, interesting, you know, content. So you have to do your research too. You have to look out there to see who is doing the work that you like. Because then you kind of start finding this alignment, this connection. So I always had something that I call my wish clients, my wish list. I always gave a lot of focus on that. So I would always look out there to see who is doing interesting work, interesting to me, of course. And then I would go, you know, and maybe try to show them my work. And so if you develop your own work, and then you go out there looking for who is doing that kind of work, eventually you're going to find the connections. And you might go to a few clients and they say, oh, that's nice. I like your work. That's cool. Okay, we'll call you if we need something. And then the next meeting you go, the person look at your work and go like, oh my God, that's what I need. That's what I've been looking for. You know, so I joke that it's like looking for, instead of like a mining operation, it's like looking for pearls or looking for a diamond, you know. Once in a while, you have to look and look and look. Once in a while, you find that right person, and then great relationships come from that, because you're going to work a lot with that agency or that client or that person, and you're going to be able to do great work. So it's not trying to please all the market, but it's finding that alignment between what you enjoy doing and what someone is doing that you think it's interesting. Did I answer your question?
Yes, we have a question from the Zoom meeting. Todd Marshall is asking, how do you feel the COVID-19 pandemic has or will influence art exhibitions and photography exhibitions?
Well, if you're talking about like art exhibitions, like in galleries and in places like that, I think that I pretty much, you know, I hope really that I think most people are really wanting to go back to normal life. I you know, of course, some people say that's going to take some time, but I think that the social media and technology and digital technology is kind of like, they were there for us, but maybe we were not using this all the time. For example, I have clients in many different places, right? So I always have a problem when people say, oh, we need to do a meeting to, we're going to start the work, the project, and can you come over here for the meeting? I would always say, well, why don't we just talk on Zoom or, you know, any Skype or anything? And so there was a lot of resistance for that. Now I see more and more people are open to that. So I think that it has also, you know, we have the negative sides of the pandemic, but I think that it opened a huge possibility for more people to show their work and to become involved, you know, in you can have, for example, virtual exhibitions, which you can, instead of like you showing your work just to a local audience, you're really showing your work to a planetary audience, you know, anywhere. So I think that this, the other side is that we're using more technology and, you know, digital communications and to spread the word. And even social media is more and more kind of like used now, where You can develop your work through social media, and you can meet other people through all the platforms out there, LinkedIn and stuff like that. You can do a lot of that kind of research. And then I think that live exhibitions and live events will eventually come back, but we're going to have more of the virtual events and exhibitions too.
Thank you, everyone, for coming to our Friday forum for this week. We are so excited for the next one already. Thank you, Marcelo, for enlightening us with your thoughts on photography, art, and visual storytelling. This is for you. On behalf of Broward, thank you. Thank you, everyone who's watching us from Zoom and everyone who's here present, our professors, our friends, they're here. And this was our Friday forum. Thank you.